Yeah. You, my God, have saved my soul. I am yours forevermore. I won't be moved of this, I'm sure. You're my God, you save my soul. I was lost when you came for me, held in chains by the enemy, but you broke them in victory. Now I'm free, I am free. You're my joy and you are my hope. I am saved by your grace alone. I will sing of your love for me. I am free, I am free. So I am yours forevermore. I won't be moved of this, I'm sure. You're my God, you save my soul. Now I stand with the King of Kings. He has paid for my every sin, and from now through eternity, I am free, I am free. You, my God, have saved my soul. I am yours forevermore. I won't be moved of this, I'm sure. You're my God, you saved my soul. Once was dead is now alive. You gave to me the breath of life. You brought me up out from the grave. I'm bursting out with songs of praise. What once was dead is now alive. You gave to me the breath of life. You brought me up out from the grave. I'm bursting out with songs of praise. I'm bursting out with songs of praise. I'm bursting out with songs of praise. You, my God, have saved my soul. I am yours forevermore. I won't be moved of this, I'm sure. You're my God, you saved my soul. You, my God, have saved my soul. I am yours forevermore. I won't be moved of this, I'm sure. You're my God, you save my soul.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. That gets you going. I don't know what will. Good morning. Welcome to Grace Baptist Church. We are glad you are here with us. If you are new, in the pew in front of you, there should be one of these little guys. Grab that and check it out. Got all the ways to contact the elders, deacons, service times, things like that, and as well as a little perforated thing on the back that you can fill out. We'd love to get to know you. Reach out to you if we can there. And also, just a reminder for all of our members and regular attenders as well that if you guys have prayer requests, if you have physical needs that we can help out with, please take advantage of those numbers, that little prayer request thing. You can also fill out there as well. We're not passing the plate right now because of COVID. By each entrance and exit, we do have a little offering box, though. So if you are filling these out as a guest, that's all we would ask for you to drop in that box, again, so we can get to know you and stalk you and tell you what we're about here. Let's go through our bulletin for the week here. Remember, our verse of the month is 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 15 through 16. Does anybody want to try to take a stab at the memory verse? Call anybody out? You guys are humble. You're like, we've already memorized it. We just don't want to gloat. Know what it is? No. This is our verse for the month. For this is the will of God, that by doing good, you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. And what a beautiful truth that we can be preaching to ourselves every single day. Also, I forgot to say hi to our members in the gym as well. Sorry, if you're not aware, if you would rather be more comfortable in a mask environment the whole time, that's what the gym is for. I'm going to go through, I guess, some COVID guidelines. You have those on your bulletin as well there. We're encouraging social distancing as much as is possible for you there. You are not required to wear a mask in here except for during the singing portion is the only time we would ask that you would wear a mask. If you don't have a mask, we do have some masks in the very back of the auditorium there. So grab one of those, or if you're maybe blocked into a pew, force whoever's on the outside to grab one for you there, or let me know when I can. Some updates. So big news, we are going to relaunch our Sunday school next Sunday. So we'll have something for our kiddos there. It'll be 9:15 to 10:15. So this will be birth through preschool. We'll be in the nursery, and then K through sixth grades will meet in the fellowship hall, which was known as Hefner, right across the coffee station there. I'm not going to read through all those, but just a couple things to highlight. All diaper changing must be done by parents. We're trying to limit as much close interaction as possible with kiddos. And also, there will be a check-in to locations to help with social distancing. Also, all adults, workers, and parents must be masked while in the kids' department. And then also, don't send any personal items, diaper bags, sippy cups, things like that. That way, we can just limit as much of that as possible there. Coming up, October 3rd, we are going to have a baby shower for Julio and Davida. They are having a baby boy, not a baby girl, that was originally put out in the church newsletter. Sorry about that, guys. They're having a baby boy, so we're happy for you guys. And also be in prayer for the Richardsons, their little baby girl, Jordan Kay. Everything's good, but just we miss them and hope to have them back soon with us. Some upcoming events here. We have a big one to point out, our Family Matters meeting. So this will be our annual budget meeting. I know it's super riveting. Can't keep you guys away from that. But we'll just talk about our budgets. And also, really, the big thing is to talk about why we do what we do and how we want to be faithful with the money that God has given us in order to get the gospel out here in Tahlequah. So we're going to have that meeting and vote on October 4th. And so with that, we always want to get the budget stuff out to you guys to review a couple weeks before that. So if you do want a budget, got all the detailed things on there, that's going to be available in the church office. So grab those after the service today. Also, our called up fast and pray, we had one, was it last week or 2 weeks ago? Time flies. Before today, we had one. And it was great just to pray through our leadership, you know, to pray for our church body together, to pray for the community, to pray for the nation, to fast throughout the day, and to pray for those things. God commands us to do that. And so it was a great time to fellowship with my brothers and sisters. If you can't be there for that, then we can get those prayer items to you, and we would encourage you to do that as you can at home. Take note of those prayer requests there. We want to be praying for our brothers and sisters who are hurting, and also those who are serving abroad there. Few more things, maybe. I already went through the Sunday school stuff. I got it. Okay. Well, before we move on to the rest of the service there, we're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to remind ourselves of our roots. And so if you'll check out on the PowerPoint, let's go ahead and stand up, and we're going to recite together the Nicene Creed. A bunch of people got together, and they said, hey, what does the Bible actually say? There are a lot of problems, heresies coming on the scene. And they said, what are the essentials? What must we agree upon in order to be in line with the teaching, the truths of God's word? And so this is what we got. It was the Nicene Creed. And so let's recite this together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, universal, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Good things for us to remember. So let's remain standing as we go to God in prayer. Thank you, Father, for being our God. Thank you, Lord, for saving people who had no claim to your mercy. Lord, would you amaze us with your goodness and your truth this morning? As we sing these songs to you, would you truly be honored? They wouldn't just be words from our mouth, but cries and prayers from our heart. We would honor you the way that you deserve with our songs, and as Ryan preaches your word to us, and as we sit under it and receive it, God, would you be our honored guest this morning and receive the glory that you deserve. We pray in Jesus' beautiful name. Amen.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Let's sing that together. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, great is thy faithfulness. Steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercy never come to an end. They are new every morning, great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, great is thy faithfulness, O Lord, great. Great is thy faithfulness. Thank you.
As we're standing, let's read God's word together. Ryan is going to be preaching out of Psalm chapter 136 this morning. We're going to do it a little bit differently here. Instead of me just reading the whole thing, we're going to treat this as a call and response. And so I'll read the first part of the verse, and you respond with, we see this refrain over and over again to drive the point home, for his steadfast love endures forever, is what you all will read there. So this is God's word. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Give thanks to the God of gods. Give thanks to Yahweh of lords. To him who alone does great wonders. To him who by understanding made the heavens. To him who spread out the earth above the waters. To him who made the great lights. The sun to rule over the day. The moon and stars to rule over the night. To him who struck down the firstborn of Egypt. And brought Israel out from among them. With a strong hand and an outstretched arm. To him who divided the Red Sea in two. And made Israel pass through the midst of it. But overthrew Pharaoh and his host in the Red Sea. To him who led his people through the wilderness. To him who struck down great kings and killed mighty kings. Sihon, king of the Amorites. And Og, king of Bashan. And gave their land as a heritage. A heritage to Israel, his servant. It is he who remembered us in our low estate and rescued us from our foes. He who gives food to all flesh. Give thanks to the God of heaven. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for this truth that your steadfast love endures forever. Holy Spirit, will you speak through Ryan this morning to rightly divide your word, to teach us what that means and what that should look like in our lives today. And would you open our eyes this morning to see wonderful things out of your law, that you would receive the honor and the glory that you deserve from our lives. We ask in Jesus' soon coming name, amen. You can be seated.
Well, you will probably never be able to guess how it was that I was so creatively able to come up with today's sermon title. Sometimes I do amaze myself. We are taking some time between books of the Bible to look at some Psalms. We looked at one last week and this week as well. We finished about a year in the book of 1 Samuel. Lord willing, we will be starting the book of 1 Peter very soon. One thing I would encourage you as we prepare to work our way through that book is that you go ahead and read it this week. And I'd encourage you to read it all in one sitting. Maybe do that two or three times even. It doesn't take long, take you 10 or 15 minutes. Some of you even have the ESV app on your phone. You can hit the play button, listen to it in the car. But you'll hear the themes, and you'll hear what's going on there and kind of catch a bit of what is happening as we work our way through the book. So I encourage you to do that this week as we prepare to study that. Well, last week we had kind of a heavy topic as we considered the raging of the nations and the wrath of God in Psalm 2. It's funny because I was thinking about it. I was like, I hope it wasn't actually encouraging, though. Encouraging for us to see the world from God's perspective and the salvation that we have in the King that he has provided. But I wanted to lighten it up a little bit this week and focus a little more on the love of God. And as you hear, that was a major theme in this psalm. the steadfast love of God for his people. Psalm 136 there, just verse 1. Listen, give thanks to Yahweh, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. So let's look at this psalm. Let's be reminded of the greatness of our God and of his love for us. This psalm, Psalm 136, has six sections to it. The first is verses 1 through 3, and it is give thanks to Yahweh. And really, what this psalm does is it's giving thanks to the Lord, and then it's telling you in each section just who this God is that we're thanking. So let's look at verse 1. Give thanks to Yahweh, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. That's what the whole psalm is about. It is a call for God's people to give thanks to Yahweh God. Now, I want to give you a reminder, because some of you might be looking at it and say, well, it doesn't say Yahweh, it says Lord there. But when you see Lord in all capital letters, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, all capital letters, that's not what you would see if you were looking at this in a Hebrew text. In the original Hebrew, what you will see there is the name of God. His name is Yahweh. And in an attempt for people not to misuse God's name or use it in vain, many translators would translate it as capital L-O-R-D rather than Yahweh, so that when you were speaking it, you would say Lord instead of Yahweh. Actually, a little side note here, I just thought of this, is that I'm thankful that the group from the Master's Seminary is actually getting ready to put out a tweak on the New American Standard Version. It's going to be called the Legacy Standard Version. And in that, one of the things they will be doing is they will be translating Yahweh as Yahweh. They won't be translating it. They will simply be bringing it out in English as it should be. So a little side note there. I'm looking forward to that one coming out this next year. But we are to acknowledge Yahweh. Who is that? He is the one true God. This is the name by which God revealed himself to Moses. You remember that story where the Lord called Moses to lead his people out of slavery in Egypt. In fact, I want to read that section of scripture. It's Exodus 3, verses 13 to 15. It says this, then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask, what is his name? Well, what shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am says sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, Yahweh, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. Now, it's kind of some strange statements in there when he says, I am, or I am who I am. And that means that I exist. I am the self-existent one. That is the Hebrew word Haya, and is tied to the Hebrew name Yahweh. God is the self-existent one. He depends on nothing and no one else for his existence. Nobody else can claim that. He is the creator and the sustainer of everything that exists. He is immutable in his character. That means that he is completely unchanging. He's not in the process of becoming something different than he already is. He is the I am. I am who I am. I will be who I will be. And he is the one who has eternal existence. He didn't begin, he didn't end. Now wrap your brain around that one for a moment. But this is the God who exists. The one who is the one who promised Moses that he would be with him and that he would be with the Israelites. And he is the one to whom we are to give thanks according to this psalm. Now listen, if that's all we knew about God, that he is the self-existent one, this creator, the sustainer, that he is this eternal being, that could actually be kind of terrifying. But look at the next thing that the psalmist reminds us of here. We give thanks to him. Why? For he is good. He is good. God is the opposite of any kind of moral evil. That word good can mean generous or pleasing or beautiful. And that really describes God well, this God who is Yahweh, the God to whom we owe a continual eternal thanks. Not only is he good, but as we stated over and over again a moment ago, his steadfast love endures forever. Now, I taught about the word steadfast love several weeks back now when we came across it in the book of 1 Samuel, but let me remind you about it here because it's obviously an important theme in this psalm. That word steadfast love is actually one word in Hebrew. It's the Hebrew word hesed. Other versions of the Bible would translate it as loving kindness, faithful love, loving devotion, mercy, gracious love. One of my seminary profs, I remember him saying that it's the idea of covenant faithfulness. Now, that might be you asking the question, well, what's a covenant? A covenant is God's committed relationship with his people, where he vows never to be unfaithful to the promises that he has made. So hesed is the idea of the unfailing kindness of God toward us, his devotion to his people. It isn't just love, it's a loyal love. It's not just that he's kind, but he's dependable in his kindness. It's not just affection, but it's committed affection. Well, so why should the people of God give thanks to God? Because he's committed to us in his covenant of love that we have in Jesus Christ. Remember what Jesus said during the Passover meal, during the Last Supper. He said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." So there's this covenant relationship that God was establishing with mankind, with his people. And God sealed his promise of his committed love to us with the blood of Jesus Christ. I want you to think about that. How could you ever doubt that God loves you when you see the price that he paid to purchase you? So according to this psalm, how long does the steadfast love of God last? As long as you're worthy? As long as you pay the right amount of tithe? As long as you are good enough? No. It lasts forever for those who are in covenant relationship with this God. His steadfast love endures forever. Look at verses 2 and 3. Give thanks to the God of gods, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his steadfast love endures forever. So who is the one to whom we are to give thanks? Well, he is the God of every so-called God. He is the Lord, the King, the Master of every Lord or King or Master on the earth. And that majestic being is the one who has steadfast love that endures forever. Look at Psalm 96, verses 4 and 5. It says this, "For great is Yahweh, and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but Yahweh made the heavens." You see, there's a truth right there, is that there are no other gods. There is only the one true God whose name is Yahweh. You know, one of the beautiful things here to see as well is the deity of Jesus Christ. Now, you might look at that and say, well, I don't see Jesus anywhere here. Well, who is the God of gods and the Lord of lords, according to Scripture? It's Yahweh, right? I mean, here we're talking about Yahweh. But look at Revelation 17, 14. It says this, "They will make war on the Lamb," that's Jesus, "and the Lamb will conquer them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And those with him are called chosen and faithful. And when he returns and he brings his wrath of God to the earth," Revelation 19, 16 describes this. It says, "And on his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written, King of kings and Lord of lords." You see, God offers his covenant love today to all who will come to him through Jesus Christ. So give thanks to Yahweh, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. The next sections go on and it describes this God who deserves our thanksgiving. So we're to give thanks to section 2, the God who does great wonders. This is verses 4 through 9. Look at verse 4. "To him who alone does great wonders, for his steadfast love endures forever." Well, what great wonders has God done? We could probably come up with a lot, but look at what the psalmist here points out in verses 5 through 9. Verse 5, to him who by understanding made the heavens, for his steadfast love endures forever. To him who spread out the earth above the waters, for his steadfast love endures forever. To him who made the great lights, for his steadfast love endures forever. The sun to rule the day, for his steadfast love endures forever. The moon and stars to rule over the night, for his steadfast love endures forever. Could there be wonders greater than this? I mean, stop and think about that. It's not possible. In order for somebody else or something else to do a great wonder, God would have had to have created them first. They would need to have been created by this being that we're describing in this psalm. And notice in verse 5, it says that he did all of these by his understanding. That word means wisdom or insight or logic. And according to Scripture, how hard did God have to work to create everything? What did he do? He spoke, and everything leapt into existence. I want to actually read a moment here out of the Jesus Storybook Bible. Some of you have this. It's a great Bible for your children and for you even, just to see the themes of Christ all the way through Scripture. But let me read just a page or two out of this. In the beginning, there was nothing. Nothing to hear, nothing to feel, nothing to see. Only emptiness and darkness and nothing but nothing. But God was there. And God had a wonderful plan. I'll take this emptiness, God said, and I'll fill it up. Out of the darkness, I'm going to make light. And out of nothing, I'm going to make everything. Like a mommy bird flutters her wings over her eggs to keep her babies hatching, God hovered over the deep, silent darkness. He was making life happen. God spoke. That's all. And whatever he said, it happened. Hello, stars, God said. Hello, sun. Hello, moon. And whizzing into the darkness came fiery globes spinning around and around, whirling orange and purple and golden planets. You are good, God said. And they were. What a being. He speaks. And creation leaps into existence from what had been nothing, other than God himself. And the being who did all of that, according to this psalm, is the being who has steadfast love that endures forever. I was looking this week at some different stats about different things in creation. And I got on the Institute of Physics, and I found some information about the moon that I found kind of interesting. All right, so the Earth on its axis is tilted at a 23.4 degree with respect to its orbit around the sun. But there's something interesting, I didn't know this, that there's actually a slight wobble, though, to its axis, to its spin cycle. And think of it, it kind of described this way. So if you took a top and you spun it, and the top's spinning, and every now and then it'll kind of go like that, right? You know what I'm talking about? When you've taken a top? Well, the Earth does that, but it's a really slow wobble, and it's really gentle. It takes about 26,000 years to get a full wobble cycle out, okay? But without the moon to stabilize the Earth, that wobble would become erratic and extreme. The Earth's axis at certain times would point straight up and down with right angles to the sun. So if that happened, the seasons would be a thing of the past. Night and day would last the same amount of time all year long. At other times, the Earth would tilt all the way over, lie on its side in relation to the sun. And so now you've got the poles being burning hot like the equator and the equator being frozen like the poles. And so what would happen is if the Earth weren't there, or the moon rather, weren't there, that would spell extreme climate change. There would be a huge difference in temperatures between daylight and night. All year long, we'd have ice ages that would come at different times every few thousand years. And I love how it ends it here as it was describing all this. It said, lucky for us that the moon is going nowhere soon. Well, you know why the moon's going nowhere? It has absolutely nothing to do with luck and has everything to do with Colossians 1:17 that says this, And this is speaking of Jesus. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. So here's this God who spoke these things into existence and then holds everything exactly as it's supposed to be. And that mighty being deserves our thanksgiving because his steadfast love endures forever. Well, what else do we know about this God in this psalm? Well, we see the third section here. He is the God who rescued his people, verses 10 through 16. Let's look at 10 through 12 first here. It says, to him who struck down the firstborn of Egypt, for his steadfast love endures forever, and brought Israel out from among them, for his steadfast love endures forever, with a strong hand and an outstretched arm, for his steadfast love endures forever. Now, many of you know the story of how God rescued his people Israel out of slavery in Egypt. And here the psalmist is referring to the 10th and final plague during that time where he struck Pharaoh and Egypt and their firstborn died because they would not let God's people go. But one of the amazing things about all of that is that was exactly what God wanted to happen. This was all part of God's plan. In fact, let's read a few of those sections. Exodus chapter 7, verses 2 through 5. God's word says this. This is God speaking to Moses. He said, you shall speak all that I command you, and your brother Aaron shall tell Pharaoh to let the people of Israel go out of his land. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart. And though I multiply my signs and wonders in the land of Egypt, Pharaoh will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt and bring my hosts, my people, the children of Israel, out of the land of Egypt by great acts of judgment. The Egyptians shall know that I am Yahweh when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring out the people of Israel from among them. And that's exactly what God did, isn't it? Plague after plague after plague until the 10th and final plague. And let's read what happened there. Exodus chapter 12, verses 29 to 32. At midnight, Yahweh struck down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of the livestock. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where someone was not dead. Then they summoned Moses and Aaron by night and said, up, go out from among my people, both you and the people of Israel, and go serve Yahweh as you have said. Take your flocks and your herds, as you have said, and be gone and bless me. You remember what happened? The only homes that weren't struck this way was the Israelite homes. Well, why was that? Because they believed God. And they had sacrificed lambs according to his word. And they spread the blood over the door frames of their house. You remember what happened then? The angel of death went through the land. And wherever the blood was covering the home, the angel passed over that. But the story didn't stop there. They had been set free, but they weren't completely free yet. Look at verses 13 through 16 in our psalm. To him who divided the Red Sea in two, for his steadfast love endures forever, and made Israel pass through the midst of it, for his steadfast love endures forever, but overthrew Pharaoh and his host in the Red Sea, for his steadfast love endures forever. To him who led his people through the wilderness, for his steadfast love endures forever. You see, Yahweh wasn't done yet. He wasn't done judging and condemning this evil people who had afflicted his people, his beloved covenant people. When Israel was leaving Egypt, they came to the Red Sea. And so here's what God said to Moses at that point. Exodus 14, 16 to 18. He said to him, lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the people of Israel may go through the sea on dry ground. And I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they shall go in after them. And I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his hosts, his chariots and his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am Yahweh when I have gotten glory over Pharaoh, his chariots and his horsemen. All this God had done for his people, Israel, and for his great name. And then he led them through the wilderness. He provided water, literally out of a rock, bread from the sky. He provided everything that they needed. Why would he do that? As the psalm reminds us, because his steadfast love endures forever. Now, I think what we can be tempted to do is look at that story and look at that rescue and think, well, that happened to Israel a long time ago. What does that have to do with me? I'm glad you asked. Because the Exodus event was really a shadow or a picture of our exodus from sin and death. You see, when you're born, you are a slave to sin. You are created and sinful already. And God put forward a Passover lamb to provide for us, to be slaughtered for us, and the God's Passover lamb for us is Jesus Christ, his son. 1 Corinthians 5:7-8 reminds us of this. It says this, "For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Let us therefore celebrate the festival, not with old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." You see, there is a day set in the future when God's judgment and wrath will come to this earth. And when that time comes, the wrath of God will fall, and the only ones who will be spared will be those covered by the blood of the Lamb. One of my favorite texts is Ephesians 2:1-5 that describes this so well. Ephesians 2 says this, "And you," he's speaking to the church here, so folks just like us, he says, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience." So think about that. Here was us. Here was them, just walking just like everybody else, living our lives like everybody else in the world. Following the prince of the power of the air, that's Satan. Not really even maybe realizing it, but we're doing the devil's will. We're doing what he would have us to do. Then verse 3, "among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind." And then I think you get to maybe the two most beautiful words in the Bible. "But God." "But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved." Now I want to pause here for just a moment and ask you, if you have come to the place of being covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now that sounds weird. I mean, we kind of grow up in that, but I would imagine somebody that hadn't heard that before, that just sounds really strange. I'm supposed to be covered by lamb's blood, by Jesus' blood. Yes. You see, we have this God who is holding out salvation to us because every single one of us have violated God's laws. And we stand justly condemned, but then we get those beautiful words, "but God." He's holding out the life and the forgiveness that he purchased in his son to you. And he's calling everyone in here to forsake your sin, your rebellion, and receive his gift of forgiveness and life. I'd urge you, don't put this off. Don't spend another minute outside of God's faithful covenant love. And listen, there's no aisle that you have to walk to do this. There's no certain prayer that you need someone to lead you through in this. You just need to call out to this God in your heart, confessing your sinfulness and accepting his gift of love and forgiveness in Jesus Christ. Jesus died for our sins and he rose from the dead to give us life in his kingdom with him. Now listen, if you want to talk more about that, please come up here, see me afterwards, see any member of the praise team. We would love to help you know this God. But church, that God that we just described there, that's the God to whom we are to give thanks. Not only that, but he is the God who in our next section, verses 17 to 22, he is the God who defeated our enemies. Let's read that whole section. Verses 17 to 22 says this, To him who struck down great kings, for his steadfast love endures forever, and killed mighty kings, for his steadfast love endures forever. Sihon, king of the Amorites, for his steadfast love endures forever, and Og, the king of Bashan, for his steadfast love endures forever, and gave their land as a heritage, for his steadfast love endures forever, a heritage to Israel, his servant, for his steadfast love endures forever. I'm sure all of you could recount the stories of Og and Sihon, right? Well, you're like me. It's like, I think I read those somewhere in the Bible at some point. We're not going to look at them, but you can. It's in Numbers chapter 21. As they were entering the promised land, this was their first taste of victory for the new generation of Israelites. But again, we would look at this and be like, what does this have to do with us? You know, we're now how many thousands of years removed from this? Well, the psalmist here is reminding God's people how God had intervened and defeated their enemies, those who would have destroyed them. But listen, our God of steadfast love has done the same thing for us. He has defeated our true enemies. Look at Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 12, says this, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places." You see, we have an enemy today, but there's really good news. Since the cross, though, he is a defeated enemy. I love how Martin Luther's song goes, "A Mighty Fortress Our God." One of the lines in there says this, "The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him." Well, why is that the case? How is it that Satan is defeated? Well, look at what Paul teaches the Colossian church. In Colossians 1, 13 and 14, he said this, "He," speaking of God, "he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." That's such an awesome picture there. This is what God has done in saving us. Here was the world again. Remember, dead in trespasses and sin. We live in this domain of darkness, and God comes and rescues us, pulls us out of that, and brings us to a different kingdom, the kingdom of his beloved Son, and where we have redemption, we have forgiveness of sins. Well, how is it that God did that? Well, Paul goes on later in Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15, and says this, "And you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him." That part there in verse 14, it talks about canceling the record of debt. You see, here's the thing. How many times in your life have you told a lie? Who thinks that they're at the top of that list? You know, a few hands. There should be several hands going up. All right? Every time we tell a lie, every time God is not the first and foremost in our heart, soul, mind, strength, every aspect of our being, every time that we are greedy, every time that we're envious of what a brother has when we don't have that, those are sins. Those are records of debt accrued on our account. Look at what that says here. He took that record of debt that Kevin Wolf has, that Ryan has, that Clint has. He took that record of debt and it went on the cross with Jesus Christ. And as those nails were being pounded in, the record of debt was being canceled that you owed at his legal demands. But not only that, look at what else it says there in verse 15. At that cross, he also disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame. Satan, you are defeated. You're just waiting for the day when you're finally cast into the lake of fire. Satan has no hold on your life. None of his accusations against you can stick. Not because you haven't done those things he might say, but because you are now clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Your record of debt is gone. Your true enemies have been defeated. You are forgiven and you are loved. Zephaniah 3:17 says this, Yahweh, your God, is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing. And the great thing is that God who has done all of that is the one who will continue to provide for you and love you, because his steadfast love endures forever. Look at the next to last section here, the fifth section, verses 23 to 25. This is the God who always provides for us. Let me read that section there. It is he who remembered us in our low estate, for his steadfast love endures forever, and rescued us from our foes, for his steadfast love endures forever. He who gives food to all flesh, for his steadfast love endures forever. When it says there that God remembered them, it's not implying that God somehow forgot, because that's impossible. God does not forget anything. He knows all things. But what it's focusing on is it's focusing on his everlasting love and care. Throughout Scripture, when you see the phrase that God remembered them, it's always going to be followed by some good action he does for his people. And notice who it is that God remembers. It isn't the worthy ones. It isn't the proud and the self-reliant. It isn't the ones who have it all together. He says it's those of low estate. Let me ask you, what is God's attitude toward the proud, according to Scripture? Many of you are quoting it, 1 Peter 5:5. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Well, who did Jesus come to save? Did he come to save the righteous, those who are working hard for this? Romans 5, 6 through 8 says this, for while we were weak at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, folks, that's when Christ died for us. Notice, too, what it says, what God was showing in the death of Christ. It says he was showing his love for us. And his love didn't stop at the cross. Psalm 136 reminds us that he continues to provide for us, his people. I love the verse, Romans 8:32, that says this, he who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Think of it that way, or this way. If God wouldn't withhold his son and slaughtering him for you, is there anything that good that he'll withhold from you? How could he? How many of you could give a hearty amen right now, acknowledging that God continuously takes care of you in love? Amen. Thank you, Lord. And that's just where the psalm ends. Verse 26, give thanks to Yahweh. Verse 26, give thanks to the God of heaven, for his steadfast love endures forever. The psalm ends right where it began. There is one God, the God of heaven and earth, and he deserves our continual thanks. Why? Because his steadfast love toward you and me never ends. Let's pray. Father, I am so thankful that your steadfast love is not contingent upon my worthiness. It's contingent upon your character. It's contingent upon what you did in Jesus Christ. So thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for the breath to pull into my lungs, to proclaim your glories and your greatness. Thank you for a family. Thank you for this church family. Thank you for giving us your word where we learn these amazing truths, where our eyes are open to your majesty and your beauty and your supremacy, where our eyes are open to what you have done for us in Jesus Christ. Thank you. Thank you for withholding what we have earned, your wrath and judgment, and granting us your mercy and favor all by your grace. Thank you, Lord. Father, forgive us for our grumbling. Forgive us for not always looking to how great you are and how good you have been to us. Thank you that greater is he who is in us than he who is in this world. Thank you that in the midst of these tumultuous times, you are the sovereign king who rules everything. And your end, your perfect end is coming as you have decreed it to be. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for bringing us into a covenant, a relationship of love with you. We love you, Lord, because you first loved us. Thank you. We pray that Christ would come soon, and we pray in his mighty name. Amen.
Let's stand together.
I will raise my voice as I lift my hands. I'll let your love take command of me. Sweet Lord, be pleased in me today. Receive my humble praise. Please set my heart ablaze as your presence fills my senses so right with your splendor and your brilliant light. In your glory I fall to my knees. I taste your goodness, and it's so sweet. Sweet Lord, rain down on me. Holy Spirit, come and set me free. Abba, Father, give me eyes to see your presence, your splendor, your glory, your goodness. Sweet Lord, rain down on me. Holy Spirit, come and set me free. Abba, Father, give me eyes to see. Receive my humble praise. We set my heart ablaze as your presence fills my senses so right with your splendor and your brilliant light. In your glory I fall to my knees. I taste your goodness, and it's so sweet. Sweet Lord, rain down on me. Holy Spirit, come and set me free. Abba, Father, give me eyes to see. I will raise my voice as I lift my hands. I will let your love take command of me. Sweet Lord,
All right, this next song we're going to close with is Forever, which seems very tied to the scripture today, so it'll seem very familiar to you. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Us forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. By his grace we will carry on, his love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing.
All right, well, some of you all had the privilege last week of heading out to the river and witnessing a couple baptisms, so I'm going to ask those girls to come on up here. Rory and Zoe. So we have two young people that have professed faith in Christ. We think it's Jesus, right? Is that right? Her dad was pretty thorough in his baptism questions. It was awesome. There, are you guys ready for the test now? No? All right. Well, as a church family, these are from us to them, okay? We are giving them copies of the Word of God. Aurora, Zoe. And in here, it says, from your Grace Baptist Church family. So it's not from me, it's from all of us. And we want to commit these girls to the Lord, to His work. We are, I know their parents have asked us to come alongside, to love them, to hold them accountable, and just like we should do with all of us, with one another. And so let me pray for them, and then I'll read a scripture and we'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you for these young lives who have professed faith in your Son. Lord, that is a work of your Spirit, that you grant us repentance and faith. It's not just something we figure out on our own. It's a gospel that has to be proclaimed, and it is a work of your Spirit within us. And so, Father, we are confident that you, the God who began a good work on them, will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. And so we look forward to that day together. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to be a faithful church, to come alongside them, to encourage them, and they would do the same for us. And so, Father, would you be glorified through our lives, in Jesus' name, amen. And since COVID, we won't ask everyone to come up here and shake hands and whatnot. So you can come up and fist bump or elbow, whatever that's called. But let me finish with this. Now may Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. You are sent.